let's see what I do here. Let me start with this. So that's a let's go back to it one more time, just so you see the gist of it. So he's going to throw those balls around those, ramp, right? That one of the ramps goes straight, the ball will go straight, and then one of the ramps is like bended with a dip and then comes up. So what I want you guys to do is to, and I'm going to have to do this slow because I have to click A, and I'm going to start pulling in a second. If you think the ball going down the flap will reach the end first, click B if you think the ball going down the dip gets to the end first, or C if you think that the two balls will reach the end at the same time. All right? And you see the pole over there? That's how you get. How you know if let's see, so we have 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, 11. We got 12 people. You gonna stay here? You gotta click, okay? You made up your mind? Okay. So now I can stop the counter and I can tell you. So I have about 33% chose the right answer. I don't know what the right answer is, but 33% chose of you. So it is at least 70, a large percentage of you are wrong, right? So suppose you're playing for points here in the class, right? Meaning that if you get the right answer, you will get a bonus point. And if you get the wrong answer, you get nothing. Right? Why don't you talk among yourself and see if you can actually come up to a better, see if we can increase that 33% to something higher. So those of you who feel really good about your answer, help the others out. Talk among yourself to see what if you guys can actually increase your percentage. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to let you click again. All right? So you can vote again. Click when you get the answer, just click. A, if you think flat gets there first. B, if you think dip gets there first. C, if you think they get there at the same time. All right, I have 14 people. Most of you are here. So how much did I say it was the first time? 33. Well, right now it's actually 7%. So should I give you guys another chance to discuss this? Imagine you're students, you're playing for bonus points, right? I mean, really nice guy, right? So let's give you another chance. So I give you another chance one last time. And I can try to make it interesting. I can say, let's say you're a student and say, well, if we can increase that percentage of correct answer to 60%, I will give all of you a bonus of 1 point in the exam. Right? So why don't you talk among yourself again? There's some people here that has to definitely be sure about the answer. So you can try to share that with the other students, and then you can vote again and see how we're doing. Okay. So now I didn't tell you what you guys were doing before, but that's what you guys think. Now, which one think A is the right answer? Any of you who chose A? Why A? It looks right, all right, all right.
I don't have any reason
about that. All right, it makes more sense. Anyone who chose B? Why B?
Because of that second dip, I think it'll speed it up.
It will speed it up, uh-huh.
It's a slightly longer pathline.
Okay, slightly longer, but you think, okay, it's kind of tricky, right? And how many chose C, which is the most popular? Okay, why C? Okay, I thought you were going to say just kind of, in case it's a trick question, right? So you go with C, right? All right, so this is one way in which we can use clickers effectively in the classroom. You see, this is an ideal question because it's simple enough that everyone understands what the problem is, but it's hard enough that I can have a distribution between all of you, and I have difference of opinions. And if I get you guys to talk about it, there's more likelihood that you will debate because you all think different things, right? Now, this is what I'm going to be talking about, this type of clicker questions and other type of questions, and how you can use the information you receive from the students in a kind of an effective way. And most of you know how to use the clicker, so we can talk after I go over the clicker questions about that. But my main goal here is to give you five type of questions that you can ask on clicker questions. And we do we go over some of them as we explain them. And you know, just stop me whenever you have questions. And then at the end, if we have time, we actually can talk a little bit about the technology if you want to implement it in your classroom. So the type of question we just saw, this question with the video, is called a concept test. Anyone have heard of concept tests before? So the concept tests are questions that are, you know, they usually have a right answer, but don't necessarily have to have a perfect answer. So this is another example of a concept test I use in my class. All other things equal, when the price of good X goes down, people usually buy more or less of the same. Right? So this is a concept. Now, this question is a concept test in which it's testing students' application of a process. It doesn't require students to do calculation, right? So when you have this type of questions, you get more likelihood of having different opinions or having different answers. Because there's no clear one answer. The student have to use what he learned in class and apply it. And they could, you know, the four options could be possibly good. This one is actually a little better because it's harder and also it's more concrete. So this is a more concrete question. All right, so let's try this one. All right, so how many of you have taken economics? All right, so you feel good. All right, so let's see. Assuming all else is the same, when the price of bagels increase, the price of cream cheese is going to tend too. And if you want to collaborate with on yourself, feel free to do that. All right, and again, just imagine that you're playing for bonus points here, right? So you really want to be right. Okay, so click your answer you got if you, okay, so I'm going to stop the counter. I can tell you that about 21% of you are right. 21% of you are right. All right, so what I like to do when I talk about this teaching techniques is to have, and I think if you were in my presentation at the TA training, you heard this. I like to talk about two levels of discussion that we're going to have here today. One is when we are in the teaching floor and you are the students and I am kind of playing the role of an instructor and we're kind of doing the thing. And then another level is kind of on the balcony floor in which we're looking down at what's happening and we're evaluating, we're analyzing the teaching situation. So when I say let's go to the balcony, what I want you to talk about is about the strategy itself and not the actual question, right? I mean, many of you are still kind of wondering whether you're right or wrong. Well, let's put that on hold and let's go to the balcony. So what do you think about this technique that we have actually seen so far, over the way I've done things? It's engaging. Why is it engaging?
You have to really think about it and like actually apply some logic to it.
Okay. Okay.
The bagel without just plain bread has to be something on it.
Okay. Yeah. So it's engaging because the content seems to be interesting. What else? What do you like? What do you don't like? Yeah.
Well, you're forcing us to pay attention because you still haven't given us the right answer to the final question.
I know, right? You're still probably wondering about the first question, right? So. You see that curiosity is, I mean, there's a lot of psychologists have done studies on this. It's almost like a physical reaction that you have when you don't know something. You know, we are curiosity really you know, makes you engage because it kind of physically wants you to know the answer. It's like, that's, I mean, we see that a lot in small and babies and small children, right? They're really, really curious. It's a natural thing we have. We're curious by nature. So by me opening that, what I call knowledge gap, I actually increase in your level of curiosity, right? And while I hold a question, the more I hold information from you, the more engaged you will be because the more curious you will be about the answer. See, once I give you the answer, you know, there's no reason to pay attention to me anymore, right? But as soon as I hold the answer, as soon as I don't tell you which ball gets faster, you're still going to be thinking about it, right? Which is what I want. So so this is why, now what am I doing? What are the techniques I'm doing to actually allow that kind of knowledge gap to increasing my students. Yeah, I'm letting you discuss it among yourself without really giving you the answer. So I'm not making anyone. So if what's your name?
Roger.
So if Roger feels really good about his answer, then he can discuss it with her a lot more, right? Because the other thing that the clickers do is that it allows you to become invested in your answer. Because I chose A, I'm not only I'm putting my grade on the line by choosing A, but I'm also want to be right, right? We all want to be right, right? So I want to be able to, if I think I'm right, I want to debate with this person. If she thinks B is the right answer, that's perfect, right? Because then they can debate why Roger thinks A is the right answer. Why does she think B is the right answer? And that's what you want, right? Students debating about those concepts. Now you see that the other thing I'm doing is I'm seeing the percentage of distribution here, and I'm telling you what the distribution of right answers are before I show you the distribution over there. Do you think that's helpful? What are the benefits or the costs of doing that? See, the alternative is I can do this and show you how you would. Okay, yeah, if you see that, that's what you would do. If you see that, if you're not really sure, you probably go with what? You might go with D or C, which seem to be the most popular. Right, so if I show you the distribution, you might tend to go in the right way, in a particular way. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing, right? Hypothetically, let's say A is the right answer, and most people are going for D or C, I might decide to show this to kind of test students even more, right? Because if D is called a distractor, right? It's a choice that could be right, but it's not necessarily right, hypothetically. I haven't told you, right? So if it's in fact, I'm trying to make the distractor kind of confuse students by showing this, that the power of that distractor is actually intensified, right? Because now most people think the distractor is working really well. Let's say the answer is B, which in fact is the right answer in this case, all right? So let's say the answer is B, and most people are going for D. Well, my distractor, or not most people, but a large percentage of them, are going for B. So this distractor is working really well, because it's doing what I want it to do, which is to kind of distract students. And when I show them this, I think most people will agree with you that they will go where the most people are, because if most people are having study, or they're not grasping the concept very well, then they will go for what other people are saying, right? So in that case, the distractor have more power because it's distracting even more. So what I could do, right, is I can tell students, I can show them the distribution, right? And then I can say, vote again. And what would we expect to happen? And actually sometimes, a lot of the times what I do is I keep the voting open, right? So for instance, right now, if you vote, you can vote if you want. See, that would change. So that's what I do in the class, right? Let's say that, hypothetically, let's say that B was really not the right answer. Now you're going for B because you gave you that, right? Even if I didn't give you bonus points, you do still want to click the right answer, right? So, but suppose that B was the wrong answer and people are going for B. Then what I can do is I stop and tell them, well, B is wrong, right? So I eliminate that one. So I eliminate the distractor that most people were going for, and I can say vote again, right? So now what I did with this one, well, these people that are going for B is wrong, they will have to split themselves among those. They still don't know where to split themselves because obviously the fact that they chose B means that they're actually not really sure, but there's definitely a percentage of people out there of students out there that felt kind of, you know, not ambivalent about that distractor, and those people should be able to still find the correct one. And ideally, what you want is to continue to do that, right, in order to kind of test students' comprehensions and test students' kind of belief about what they think is right in this particular case. All right, questions about So this technique was developed by this guy in Harvard called Eric Mazur, and it's called peer instruction. And it basically works in this way. You poll the students once with them answering the question with a question like this one. It should be conceptual because if you have, like, for instance, a calculation problem, then if you get a calculation problem, what kind of answer you will expect or what kind of distribution you will expect? Yeah, in a calculation, when you do the diagram like this, you get even more kind of skewed distribution because you made the calculation right and you usually come to the right answer. So most people are going to go for one answer. So it doesn't mean that those questions are not good clicker questions. It just means that to do for this type of activity that we just did, peer instruction in which you allow the students to click once and then you get a list. You get a particular responses, and then you allow the students to vote, to discuss among themselves and vote again. Calculation questions are not really good. Are better if you deal with questions like this ones, which are more conceptual. Here's another one. If taxi cab drivers could charge whatever fares they wanted, what would happen to the price of cab drivers in high-crime neighborhoods? So let's think about this one for a second, just to see the idea of the clickers. All right, so show of hands, how many people think the answer to this is A? How about B? Show of hands. C, D, E? All right, so there's a lot of people who hold their answer, right? Okay, so what are the differences? I'll go back to the balcony, right? So what is the difference between the show of hands and the clickers?
You can see who's answering before you get your answer.
Okay, so if you are not sure about the answer, you're seeing how many hands are there, so you're seeing kind of the distribution right in front of you. There's no way for me to hold that information from you.
Clicker's anonymous.
Huh?
Clicker's anonymous.
Yeah, it's also, that's the other part, right? Very good. It's also not anonymous, right? If I think A, and I don't feel really sure, I think there was, in this area around here, right, I just don't vote. I just don't raise my hand, right? Which is usually what I do when I go to conferences, right? I just never raise my hand, right? So unless I'm really, really sure what I'm doing. So there's no way for me to give you any credit or discredit for actually not raising your hand. So those are kind of the any other benefits that you see that the clickers have in addition to the show of hands? What else would you use clickers? I can also give you credit, right? Like I said, I can give you credit because this is tied up to a particular student. So I know if Roger press D and he gets it right, I can give him some credit, extra credit. And then some other student who actually chose a different answer, I can give him that to that other student less credit, or I can give him no credit at all. So this is actually it's a higher stake. It's still low stakes depending on how I do the grading, but it's still higher stakes than raising your hand. So which one do you say, the price increase? That's in fact the answer. So concept test, again, this question is a little too easy for a concept test. If I had done the distribution, I would have gotten a distribution which was most people, let's say 90% of students chose one answer. The good questions for peer instructions are the question in which the first two we have, right? That people were split up among the answers. Concept tests are really good also when you're actually doing demonstrations like the one we did or actually watching videos and then have a question about the particular video you actually seen. Let me see if we can get this video to play here. Thank you. So what I like is to show students videos like that, and then after they're kind of invested in it, then pose a question, right? Which is related to the video, and again, it should be related to the material they should have covered, they have read on their own, but it kind of forces them to go a little bit step further, right? So in this particular one, I want them to tie up what happened. Obviously, the price went up to a particular change in the graph. Okay, questions about concept test. So here's the next type of questions are kind of the more traditional questions that people use with clickers. Those are what we call I call them "Are you with me?" questions, right? So these are basically questions that I just cover a little bit on the lecture, and after 10 minutes, there's plenty of research, right, to say that after 10 minutes you lose at least 50% of your audience. Doesn't matter if you're doing flip-flops here, right? You're going to lose 10%. That's just attention, dynamics in people. So after 8 or 10 minutes in the lecture, I stop, right? If I do this type of questions, and I just ask him a question, and an "Are you with me?" type of question. Like, for instance, the following will be a good example of a concept test. What do you think? I just told you what concept tests are, right? So which one is a good example of it? So you can click whenever you get the answer to this one. See, if it's a concept test, you would expect most people to be kind of divided, because in the questions we saw before, the distractors were really good, and they should have actually, I mean, a couple of the choices in the questions we saw before could have possibly been in the answer, right? It was a really tough questions. In this particular questions are supposed to be less ambiguous, right? This question should definitely have a right answer, right? Perhaps there's two distractors that could potentially be, but this question should be more about recalling material that you study and then kind of spitting out the answer without having to apply too much. So I would expect, if I do the distribution, to see that, and that's kind of what I see, right? Most people went for one answer, which in this case is the right one. Now I also agree that while E is still kind of what is the right triangle, you can probably do that with recall, right? So a concept test is probably the question here that is kind of harder and kind of more ambiguous of the five. And you will probably have to apply some of the stuff that you learn by doing things more than just factual or definition kind of stuff. What was I going to tell you about concept test on this one? So are these questions good or bad for clickers? I mean, they're just different type of questions. These questions are good for kind of seeing if the class is getting what you're saying. If most people are getting it, then you move forward. People are not, then you do something else. But I don't know if you noticed that, but these questions are a little harder to get discussion because most people know what the answer is, right? So what's the point? There's really not that interesting in having a discussion like that in this particular case. So this is a good example of "Are you with me?" questions. Here's another example. I think I've used this one before with you guys in the training, right? In what year did Charles Darwin? There's only one answer here, right? There's only one answer that is right, which is what? Should I open it? You guys know how to answer? Let's see if you got the answer on this one. Most of all of you voted already, all right? So let's see what you guys said. So there are three people who went for, it's a trick question. That's good. Always to assume that I'm tricking you in something. But it's actually not a trick question. It's actually A, 1859, right? So you know what? 1776 is the Declaration of Independence. 1970, I told you, right? That's born of a great economist, right? One of the best ones in the country. That was me, by the way. 1800 is, Larry King was born that year. It's not a trick question, 1859, right? But this is just only one answer here. Now, here's the thing. I mean, these questions are good for the exam because, you know, they're really not unambiguous. So if you have a multiple choice exam, they work well. The questions that I had before, the concept test, some of them are not necessarily good questions for exams because they're debatable, some of the choices, but they're great questions for the class because that's what you want in the class. You don't want the students to have ambiguity in the exam, but in the class it works well because you can have discussion. It's less effective to have discussion with this type of question. So now there's a lot of questions that are kind of in between, like something like that. See, that's, it's kind of like a are you with me question. So no, so ignore this for the time being, ignore this this little thing on here and concentrate on the question. And I want you guys to tell me is this, is A, B, or C? Not answer the question, but whether you can answer the question. Yeah. So A, B, or C? A, B, or C? I have 12, two people that haven't decided yet whether they feel good or bad about the question. And then if I stop, then we can look at the distribution of this, right? And see what people think. And it looks like I have half of you feel really good about answering the question, right? About 43%. And another 43% are kind of sure. So I have about 86% of you think at least a 50% sure you can answer this question, right? So let's see if that's true. Answer it. All right. So now you're going to go for A, B, or C, which one you think is the right answer. All right. Now let me zoom in again to make sure that you can actually read the question well. So now you're answering. And you know, just to make it even, to be nice, you can talk to the person next to you if you think you don't know the right answer, right? Or if you want to help out. But a lot of you should answer correctly because 96% of you felt at least 50% good about it. All right, so 96% was 86% of you felt that you actually could actually this question right. Let's see how you guys did. Whoa. Now, what does that mean?
They're all sure in different ways.
That's one thing, right? They're all sure in different ways. But what else? What else does it mean? I mean, what's going on here? Is there anything particularly interesting about my students, in this case you, that I can discern from these two things? Huh? What is it? Yeah. Well, one is that most of you don't know how to calculate the opportunity cost, right? But that's okay. I mean, you haven't taken the class in econ probably for a long time. But that actually was kind of expected. But what was the most interesting to, what is the additional thing? Yeah, I mean, it's just like, obviously, at least 86% of you were at least 50% sure that you were right. But you cannot, that cannot be true. I mean, a lot of you have to be wrong because there's only one answer here. And most of you, you know, a lot of you went for all kinds of way, right? So let's say that this is the right answer. 20, 33, all these people had the wrong expectations. You actually were misjudging your knowledge, right? Because you thought you knew it, but you obviously don't, right? Because there's actually one answer here. Now, you shouldn't feel so bad if you don't know the answer, because this particular question, there was a study done in which a group of students presented this question to people who have actually just taken an economics course in Cornell University, and only about, 8% of them were able to answer the question correctly. These are economics, you know, students. Then they presented the question to people who have never taken economics, and actually 15% of them were able to answer the question, right? So the funny thing is that those people, after they did the study, they said, wow, we're really into something here, right? So they presented the question at the major economic conference to all the PhD economists that were there, right? And only 30% of them were able to answer the question, right? Now, after they were shown that there was the focus group and stuff, and they would say, well, why did you show the wrong answer? And a lot of them economists say, well, I thought you were talking about net opportunity costs instead of gross opportunity costs, concepts that don't really exist, right? So they were kind of justifying why there's only one correct answer here, and the correct answer is B, 10, right? Because what you consider is what the cost of, so we're still in the floor, right? What you consider here is that what you lose from what the benefits that you won't be able to get if you go to their concert, right? If your benefits that you won't be able to get are, well, if you actually don't go to see Eric Clapton, you go to see Bob Dylan, you have to pay $40, So where the benefits that you get from seeing Bob Dylan is $10. And that's what you lose if you go to see Eric Clapton. Right? You lose a surplus. Now, that's economics. Right? You don't have to care about that. But the important thing is that this is what I do in my class. See, this is one thing that students don't do very well, because a lot of them, for the most part, actually none of us, were taught how to think, how to study, how to think about thinking, right? So this is a type of question that I call thinking about thinking, all right? Which is like what we call metacognition. Any of you have heard about this concept before? So it's really important because, you see, before the exam, I put questions like this to my students. I poll them twice. I poll them the first time, like I did with you, how many of you feel confident about answering this question? And for the most part, it's the same thing. I mean, you get to, and I put questions that are kind of hard, but not exactly, right? So, and then most of them say they feel pretty confident. Then I poll them, and then I face them with the results. And then they're seeing themselves that their expectations about how much they know are incorrect. So what is, and then I ask them, if your expectations about what you think is right, what do you think is going to happen in the exam? Well, they're going to go to the exam, they're going to feel they study enough, they're going to take the exam, and there's two possibilities that will happen if their own expectations are wrong. One is that after the exam, they know they bombed the exam, right? And they're upset because, oh, I thought I had studied, but I still did really wrong the exam. And two, they do the exam, they think they did really well because they're still thinking they are right. And then when the grade comes, oh, how come I got this grade? It's impossible. You know, there must be something wrong with the instructor, with the teacher, because there's no way I felt really good about this exam, right? But you don't want to deal with that after the exam. You should deal with that in some way. And most of all, actually, in the fact, we don't deal with that issue. But you want to deal with that before the exam. So you can actually encourage students to do different kind of things. So what kind of things do you think would you encourage to your students to do if you feel that there's discrepancy between what they think they know and what they really know? How can they fix that? What do you think? If you have to face it, you're faced with that situation. I send one of my students to you because you know the answer to this problem. How do you fix the problem of expectations of they know versus what they really know? What should they do to correct that? Change their study. I will go there first, right? So there's something with your studying that is actually not working really well. So what kind of things do you think they're doing in their study that is actually not enough? How do you think these people are studying? They're probably concentrating more on reading the chapter, right? How do you know that you know something? You can apply, okay. What else? When you study for an exam, are you getting your test? You probably still studying for exams, right? How do you know that you know something? How do you study?
When I see that I can do the problem.
Okay, when you see that you can, and how do you know that you can do it on your own, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So if you take a problem and you can't answer it, and then you look at the answer, and they say, oh, well, of course, that makes sense. Do you know it?
No,
right? So most students think they do know it when they do that, right? They do the problem, they get it wrong. Oh, by the way, what is it wrong? And then they look at the answer key. Oh, of course, that makes sense. Of course, right? And then, okay, I know it. I just keep going to the next one. But they don't know it yet, right? But the most students think they do know it, right? The only way you know, there's two basic ways. And like you guys said, there's two basic ways that you know something. One is you do the problem on your own and you solve it on your own, or two, you're able to explain it to someone in your own words. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, if students don't believe, these questions of quicker questions with them, all of them at the same time are really good to kind of convince them that this is something that they should spend time doing, right? And changing some of the study habits. Thinking about thinking, that's another one. The other one are kind of polling. What do you think type of questions, right? So, I do this question when I talk about elasticity of demand. I talk about drugs, and then I ask them this other question. Now, the cool thing about these clickers is that I can actually do, I can take a question like this. Let me go back here. And do the polling is anonymous. So I can all ask you to answer the question, and there's a small way that I can actually get the, I can tie your answer to yourself, right? So why don't you answer and tell me what you think? I want to know what you guys think. Let me go back. About the drug problem. And let me stop. I know you got most of you already, and this is what you guys think. So A, strong legalization. Most people are in favor of strong enforcement. All right. And then what I can do now is I can go to my students. Some people vote for E. I'm really interested to see which one was that one. But what I can do is I can tell my students, why do you feel that way? And all I'm going to do, I tell them, all I want to do is to hear from you. I'm not going to put any judgment. So how many of you chose A? So why A?
Fear. People are really driven by the fear of getting caught.
And you think that works better?
Yeah.
Okay. Is she wrong? Is she right? There's no way for me to tell her whether she's right or wrong, right? So this question is different. There's no right or wrong answer here. But still, the fact that you're choosing something, it makes you invested in your answer. So it makes you kind of like a little more engaged in the class. And this is what I do. And then I take, you know, samples. And then after I've taken your sample, after you have taken a position, after you have or perhaps even told me verbally what you thought, then I start talking about it. And at that point, you should be a little more engaged because you have already taken a position. So these questions are actually very useful, even though they're completely different from the peer instruction questions we did before. There's no right or wrong answer, so I wouldn't do what we did before. But this is another type of question that I do in my class. What's your eating strategy when you go to all-you-can-eat buffet? So most people here, what's your eating strategy? B. Eat a little more than I normally do, all right? Is anyone actually will pick A? The minority, right? A. Have you taken economics before? Okay, good. Why you do A? I was going to say good. You're being a good economic actually. Because an economist will also choose A, yeah. Okay, you're not gonna. So I mean, the idea here is sunk cost, right? It says like if you already pay for the money you pay for the buffet is already gone, right? So I'd rather be $5 poorer and be completely feel fine than be $5 poorer and have a stomachache after eating all the food there, right? So, but anyway, these are good questions. There's no right or wrong answer here again. So these are good questions that you can do for people to kind of to tell you what they think and whether they believe on something is. And then you can get them to talk about it before you actually do the thing, right? So they have an opinion about things. So this is another one I put in my very first class. And those international students know that we talk about that in the TA training, right? I like to put it out there that I do have an accent. And it's not going away, right? And you know, different people have different opinions about this one. Most people in this one usually pick D. But you know, I don't really try to brag about that. I tend to be very humble. Okay, so here's another one, should funding public school students score? These are really good questions for use with clickers. And then the last one is classroom experiments. Not all of you will be able to use this. How many of you see stats classes? So I think for stats you could do this, and econ classes you can do this. It's basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to develop data in the class to develop the concept. So in this particular one, what I'm trying to do is to poll the class on their answer, I'm gonna draw out a demand curve, right? Based on their answers. In here, I do kind of the same thing. I want to poll the class and then use the results to talk about the fact that most, in this particular case, most clothes that they actually will come up will probably be on C and D, perhaps. So I want to use that information that we have in the classroom to introduce the topic I'm going to talk about. So those are really useful for those kind of things. And then in economics, we have a bunch of experiments that we do because it's a lot about behavior. So this is one of the experiments I do in my class to talk about the issue of free rider. And I collect information in the experiment using the clickers. So questions? You guys want to know what happens? Yeah. Want to see it again? Which one was it? Do that one more time. Dip, all right? Dip was the right answer. How many of you chose dip? I think it was about 30%, right? So you were right. It's longer, right? That's why it's hard. It's longer path, but it picks a little speed as it goes down, right? OK, any questions about clickers? Anything that you, about technology or anything else that is on your mind if you are thinking of using them?
What are you in right
now? Oh, yeah, this is called Prezi. It's kind of a different type of nonlinear presentation software. I'm going to do a workshop on Prezi on April 7th, if you want to know how to use it. It's actually pretty cool. I'm actually almost 75 of my presentations now I've actually done on Prezi. Students tend to like it a lot, too, because you can see the map. So let me tell you that we have, if some of you want to use the clickers just one time in your classroom, just for just to try it out, we have a bunch of clickers that I can actually lend you. And then you can use them in your class and bring them back to us. And we have enough clickers that even if you're teaching a large class, we can actually provide that for you. So I really encourage you to actually use those and try it out on your own to see if it works. And kind of let me know how it goes. I always enjoy that. There's different technologies. I think I like this one the most because of it's more robust, and also because I can actually tell how many people answer which question without showing them the answer. All right, that's all I have. So thank you guys a lot.